Now, just a short personal story. In 2014, I was a World Fellow at Yale University in Connecticut, and Hillary Clinton had not yet announced her candidacy. But there were some PACs or groups already working to prepare, and one of them was selling these champagne glasses. I don't know if you can see them. It says Hillary 16, or Ready H 2016. I decided to buy six of them to be prepared. 2 years later, brought them home to Iceland, and then we all know what happened. But last week, a woman was elected the Vice President of the United States, and that was, I think, enough to bring those glasses out again that have been in the cupboard for 6 years, more or less. But the fact that the Reykjavík Global Forum is digital this year has some advantages to it. For example, that we can have Hillary Clinton with us today. It's been 25 years since her famous speech in Beijing, where she said, "Women rights are human rights." And in this fireside chat recorded yesterday night, conversationists Hillary Clinton and Melanne Verveer reflect on progress made and look ahead to what remains to be done to advance women's equality and leadership.
Secretary Clinton, it is just delightful to be back with you today. And I want to begin, if you're willing, to ask you how you're feeling since the outcome of our election was announced.
Well, I am feeling better than I have felt in 4 years, Melanne. I feel really happy and relieved, very grateful, excited about the team of Joe Biden and Kamala Harris, looking forward to seeing them take the office of president and vice president and bring our country together and get us back on the right track for the future.
Yeah, it's a very celebratory mood here in many segments of this country, for sure. One of the things I know we're all hoping for, particularly all of us gathered at this WPL summit, is to see greater progress for women and girls the world over. And it's 25 years now since that fourth UN World Conference on Women that took place in Beijing. And I think that we still hear echoes of what you said. Human rights are women's rights, and women's rights are human rights. And perhaps you could talk a little bit about what you intended to do. What was your goal in Beijing? Just explain the sense of what that conference meant.
Well, Melanne, I really hoped that the United States and other countries would come together in Beijing back in 1995, both with the official delegates and the activists who gathered, to chart a platform for action, an agenda for moving women's rights, opportunities, their full participation in society to the very top of the list of what global challenges should be addressed. And it was exciting because out of that conference did come a platform for action. Obviously, that was hard work. It was negotiated late into the night. But in the end, 189 countries signed up to it, and it has proven to be durable, to set our goals, to keep people motivated, to work toward them. And I think looking back now from a 25-year vantage point, we can see the progress we've made, and we can see where still much more needs to be done.
And how would you assess some of that progress?
Well, I think that the report that you spearheaded really summed it up well. We can see gains for women, parity in education in many countries, far fewer deaths in childbirth, greater access to health care, more women elected to positions in governments, more opportunities in the business world. Yet I think it's also fair to say major gaps persist. The women's paid labor force participation has stagnated globally. And as you know, It is going backwards now because of COVID-19 and many women leaving or being forced to leave the workforce. Women carry the heaviest burden of unpaid work in the home and family. We have a very serious, persistent problem of sexual and physical violence perpetrated by an intimate partner. That seems also to have gone up during this pandemic. And although we've made some progress in business and government and politics, I think it's fair to say that women are still largely left out of decision-making roles from local governments to the very highest levels, which I'm excited to say is beginning to change in our country with the election of Kamala Harris. And so we have a lot of work to do in continuing the progress in education and health, but working much harder in business, in politics and government, and in an area that you are focused on, peace and security.
You know, one of the things that we concluded as we were working together with you on looking back those 25 years and looking forward in terms of what hasn't been achieved and needs to be, was the fact that there are barriers and obstacles that still stand in our way. And among them are norms and attitudes that still prevail, the kind of pushback we're experiencing in many places. How can we overcome those hurdles?
Well, I think one of the important contributions of the report that you issued is to look at these norms as barriers. Because we've seen a lot of progress in changing laws and regulations. We still have much to do to enforce them, whether it's women's inheritance or access to promotion and hiring in business. But many of the laws have been changed, and many of the governments now give lip service around the world to women's equality in the public sphere. But let's be clear, the norms, the values, the deeply held biases that unfortunately are still so prevalent continue to hold women back. And they even work in a very perverse way, as you know, Melanne, for women to hold themselves back, to feel that they're not good enough, they're not smart enough, they're not ready enough for a job, for a promotion, to run for office in a democracy, to stand up, to speak out for their rights and the rights of other women and girls. So focusing on those norms, sort of pulling them out into the bright sunlight, making it clear that they are barriers, that they influence decision-making so that people can actually come to grips with it, I think is going to be a major challenge for the media across the world that still likes to categorize women, put them into neat little boxes, focus on appearance and all the things which we know they do. But also for the public at large, as well as for governments and decision makers, so that we can get closer to achieving the kind of equity in roles and participation in society that we are really aiming for.
You know, just in what you've said, you've obviously underscored the importance of women's political participation. And we're here gathered in this WPL summit with so many women leaders from around the world. And yet, as you did point out, that gap, particularly for women's political participation, still has some distance to go to being closed. And I wonder if there are ways in which we can better close that political gap. You mentioned women's confidence. Are there structural changes that can be made? Are there more things that we all should be doing to make sure that we don't have such a chasm between men and women in terms of women's political leadership still?
Well, as you know, there have been experiments in, you know, lots of countries about what could be termed quotas or setting standards, setting numbers. And, you know, maybe that should be tried in more places, particularly in parliamentary systems where you can set lists of candidates where the party itself can try to give a boost to more women running and being elected. So I think that that's an opportunity in a lot of different democratic systems. I think more women in government positions, not just running for office, but frankly, being put into high-level public positions where they can demonstrate their competence and their expertise will be a big help. In a system like ours, where the parties play a minor role, people literally can run no matter who you are and where you come from, under most circumstances, I think it's more encouraging more women. You know, Melanne, I worked hard the last 4 years to support groups that are recruiting women candidates, training women candidates, helping to raise money for women candidates, because there needs to be a very deliberate effort focused on the infrastructure necessary to really support women running. And then we have to continue to call out the sexism and misogyny in the political arena and particularly in the press.
Those are such good points. And we know, as you were saying from your own experience, how much it matters when these opportunities are available to potential women candidates so that they can mount the kind of campaign that will be successful. You wrote a really incredibly important piece in The Atlantic on the occasion of this 25th anniversary of the Beijing conference. And it was focused on women's progress and where we still need to go. And you underscored the word power, women and power. Can you talk about that some? Because I think it's a really important point.
Well, thanks for mentioning it. And I hope the participants for the WPL conference will take a look at it, because the argument I basically made is that 25 years ago, we focused on rights. We needed to claim our rights. We needed to have governments recognize our rights. But without the power to really inhabit those rights, we don't get as far as we should. We have them on paper, but we don't have them in reality. So I think this next stage of women's political progress has to be focused on not only getting women in power, because let's be honest, there are some women in power who slam the door on women's rights and on women's opportunities. They're not interested, and they're really pursuing a different political agenda. So we have to focus on getting women who are very determined and committed to increasing the space for women in family, community, government, business, society in general. And I think that has to be the priority of our women leaders, because only we have the platforms often to point out the unfairness and the inequities and the backsliding, which sadly we've seen too much of. I make the point in the article that one of the first things authoritarians and nationalists do is push back on women's rights. We've seen it in Europe. We're seeing it now in Poland. We've certainly seen efforts in our country that are still being, argued over. But it's true globally. And women were the first to lose our jobs in the pandemic, the last to be rehired, oftentimes having to leave the workforce to care for children because the economy has not recovered. We need women in powerful positions to really speak up for all women, but particularly for marginalized women, for poor women, for women who are otherwise not given as strong a platform and as powerful a voice. So power really is at the center of our thinking now, and we need to have more women in power, more women who want to help empower other women, and more men as allies for the empowerment of women, and to create as clear and open a set of opportunities for women to pursue their own interests and their own dreams in the future.
Well, those are great marching orders for all of us. We literally have less than a minute left, and I wonder if you would just use the couple minutes we have to talk about COVID, and since it's disproportionately impacted women, how we can build back better so that these inequalities can, for once and for all, be taken care of.
Well, very quickly, Melanne, every government has to prioritize the economic recovery for their countries, but with particular attention paid to the disproportionate number of women who have lost their jobs, lost their source of incomes, and particularly single parents who are raising their children alone. So let's be sure that we remember the terrible damage of COVID as we try to build back from this global pandemic.
Well, thank you so much, Secretary Clinton. There's never enough time, but we're grateful that you joined us for this. And as you always say, onward, onward together. Thank you so much.
Thank you all very much.